Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.
Hey, now let's take a moment so we all can figure it out, what it's all about. It's the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline, the Homework Hotline.
Welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Craig Zaramba.
And I'm Donna Minio. This season, Homework Hotline has a few changes. The first big change is that we will no longer be taking live phone calls to help you with your homework. Dial Teacher, the organization that sent homework questions to the show, was experiencing a decrease in calls while facing funding shortages.
Dial a Teacher decided to close their call center and look for new ways to support students through Homework Hotline and online resources. Although we will no longer be taking live homework help calls, we'll continue to have our daily challenges such as the Math Maze, Creature Teasers, and Brain Teaser, and the Science Challenge.
We will still be having our Hotline Hall of Fame and giving away 3 tablets at the end of the season in April. The Hall of Fame will also be split into 3 different age ranges. One person from each age range will win a tablet. Cool. However, if you won a tablet last season, you are not eligible to win this season. You can still participate in our daily challenges and still get points, but you cannot win a tablet. That means that we will have 3 new winners this year. For the official rules, please visit our website, homeworkhotline.org.
We will also be having discussion questions this season, and we want to hear what you think about important issues facing our community. You'll be able to tell us what you think on Twitter, Facebook, and on our website. The most thought-provoking responses will be put on the air.
We will continue to have our friends from the Seneca Park Zoo, Rochester Museum and Science Center, and other guests from the community on throughout the year. This season, Homework Hotline will be giving you the tools needed to succeed in both in and out of the classroom. We'll be focusing on things you need in the real world.
We'll also want to remind our viewers that a little later in the show, the Seneca Park Zoo will be here to tell us about what citizen science is and their project called One Cubic Foot. Cool.
And now, let's get to this season's first creature teaser.
This amphibian can be found in the tropical lowlands from southern Mexico throughout Central America and into northern South America. This nocturnal carnivore will hide in the rainforest canopy and ambush crickets, flies, and moths with its long, sticky tongue. During the day, you might find this green creature asleep on leaves.
If a predator disturbs them while asleep, they open their red eyes wide and reveal their huge webbed orange feet and bright blue and yellow sides. This technique, called startle coloration, may surprise a bird or snake, allowing the amphibian to spring to safety. This animal is not endangered, but their habitat is decreasing at an alarming rate. If you think you can solve the creature teaser, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Every correct response we added to our Hotline Hall of Fame, earn enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season. Cool. That color startleration, deer do that. They call it stolting. They put up their tail and it's white and tells other deer that, hey, there's something dangerous around. Run.
Oh, wow. That's cool.
Yep. So I have some science qualm problem or a lesson I'm going to go do on the board.
That sounds great.
All right. So as it's the beginning of the school year, we review. And one of the things that I like to do with all my classes, we talk about what the scientific method is. And as we progress from like 7th grade into 9th grade and in higher math, sometimes they use different words. They might not use just scientific method. It might be scientific inquiry or an investigation. But it still all means the same thing. And it is a systematical or systematically and logical approach to solving problems. So I use an example with my kids in my class. And when you think about it, we do science every single day, all right? And I tell my students this, you know, we have game systems, we use these game systems, so when we use it, we know there's a certain procedure that happens when we start the system up, all right? So you get out a disc, you put it in the system, you turn it on, and then you wait, and something should happen. So if it doesn't happen, you start processing and start thinking science. Well, how come it was working this morning? I played the game, and now it's not working, all right? So if you think of the scientific method, think of like following a recipe, all right? If you're gonna make brownies or a cake and it's from a box, you look on the box, it tells you exactly what to do. And if you want to alter the recipe a little bit, it tells you how to do that as well, all right? So when we start science with anything, we make an observation, all right? And you're gonna use your five senses. You're gonna smell something, taste something, touch something, see something, or hear something. So going back to our game system, you turn on the TV, you turn on your system, and you put the disc in, or the cartridge, or whatever it is, and then you wait. Something appears on the screen. And you know this because you have past experiences playing this system. And if it doesn't do that, then you start, you've made your observation, it didn't do what it was supposed to do. So then you go to this. You ask a question. Why isn't my game system working, right? So that's the easy question. How much, how far, how many, what color? The harder question here is, why isn't your game system working, all right? So now you're gonna start forming a hypothesis. And kids in elementary school, they learn this way back like in second, third grade, that it's an educated guess. And science isn't really about guessing, all right? We're working more on stating it as an if-then statement. So I told my students this year, if you write down an educated guess, I'm gonna mark it wrong, because I'm teaching you that you gotta put it in an if-then statement. So if your system is hooked up and the power is connected and you're using the right disc in that game system, then that system should operate. The reason being because you have had prior history playing that game, you've had prior history and experiences using that system. So this hypothesis is an idea that you can test, all right? And in doing forming your hypothesis, you might actually do a little research. In a laboratory, you might go online and research other papers, other systems that other scientists are working on, or it might be as simple as, hey, asking your little brother and sister, were you playing my game system last night? Did you get jelly on the disc or something like that, all right? So now, after you ask your question, all right, you're gonna design and conduct your experiment. Here we got this guy here, looks like he's working with some snow, maybe he's making some measurements, all right? In your design and conducting experiment, you take the disc out, you blow on it, you wipe it on your shirt, you stick it back in the system, you press the button again, maybe you fixed it, maybe you didn't. So you still have in your brain, you have set up an experiment. You've tried something to see what that caused to happen, all right? Now you're gonna start collecting and organizing data. And in your brain, you've already had this already things that work and things that don't work. So you have a list of things to fall back on for this system and for other problems that you come encounter throughout your life. I know when I work on things in my house, I don't make a data table, but in my mind, I have, okay, this works because I have the power to the system, I have used the right, and I've got my controller, and all these things are connected, so now I have data collected, all right? And what I'm actually looking for is I'm gonna be looking for patterns, trends, and anomalies. All right, maybe my cat got behind the TV and chewed through the HDMI cable. So now I have my system on, the power's on, the disc is in, the TV's hooked up, and there's no signal going to the TV. So now when I go to play it, I got nothing going on. So the very last thing, and this is probably one of the most important parts of our scientific investigation, our scientific method, is drawing a conclusion. Now we're not gonna physically sit and draw a picture, but here's where I'm gonna present the findings of my investigation. The data that I collected, the information, my evidence, I'm gonna propose this is what caused the problem, why my system is not working. And more importantly is I'm gonna present this information to peers. These are people, your friends, your colleagues, people that are working on similar systems or similar problems. The reason you're gonna do this is because they have different life experiences. So they might say, did you try hooking up these two cables? Or on your settings in the computer system, there's something that you have to do before you initialize that disk. So they might give you ideas that you didn't think about when you actually came up with your own conclusion. So when we go back to our scientific method here, all right, remember, you guys do science every single day. Open the refrigerator door and watch what happens. That's doing science. Thanks a lot.
Argentina is the second largest country in South America and the eighth largest country in the world. Argentina is known for its diverse geographical landscape that allows for a variety of animals to call this country home, animals such as the cougar, jaguar, and the ocelot can be found in the north, along with crocodiles, flamingos, turtles, and tortoises that live in the subtropical north. In the south of Argentina, there is the Patagonia that is home to the elephant seals, fur seals, penguins, and sea lions. And in the waters of the Atlantic near Argentina, you can find sharks, orcas, dolphins, and salmon. But as the country develops, these areas are starting to be affected by deforestation and pollution. About 95% of Argentina's population can trace its heritage back to European descent. When Europeans immigrated to Argentina, they also brought over diseases which killed off many of the native people. Because of these strong European influences, Buenos Aires, Argentina's capital, has been called the Paris of South America.
All right, tonight on Homework Hotline, we'll be learning about citizen science and the project called One Cubic Foot. Take a look.
My name is David Latoire, and I'm from San Francisco. And I came up with this idea to explore how much life you can find in a small place through this One Cubic Foot project.
One Cubic Foot is the perfect vehicle for teaching about ecosystems and biodiversity. So the Seneca Park Zoo Society invited David Litschwager here to Rochester to replicate the project in the Genesee River.
I mean, it's this spot right up here.
This little green metal frame is put out in the landscape. You have to figure out where you're going to put this. What spot are you going to choose? I'm looking for a place of maximum diversity. There's algae, roots, and where can I put this frame that encapsulates the most diversity of life? You have to look around a lot, and that takes some real time and some real attention. And it also is, you know, you're a little nervous. Did I choose the right spot?
The turning point is where there's the big public walkway.
Yeah, that's which all of.
Or is it better 3 feet down?
The Genesee River has been on the EPA's area of concern list for decades. As the water quality has improved, the zoo and its partners have been reintroducing native species to the river. We invited David to help us find out what's living in the river right now.
He searched along about 5 miles of the river.
Yeah, not too shabby, huh?
It's beautiful.
From the marina up to the lower falls. Spent many, many hours on the river, over 3 days. And we finally chose a spot that was at Turning Point. This spot in the Genesee River, it's one of the more eccentric spots when you compare it to some of the other ones that I've done that have been a bit more pristine. There's never been any human structure in any of the other cubes. There's two pilings right next to the cube, you know, evidence of industrial use of the river over many, many, many decades.
This is our spot.
You know, as we go through it, we'll find out whether it was a good spot or not.
All right, and now we'd like to welcome Dave from the Seneca Park Zoo to the show. Hey, Dave,
how
are you doing?
Thank you guys very much. How are we doing?
Cool. So what is this?
So I have, as the video explained, I have a little bit of a sample from the Genesee River.
Okay.
And what I did was, this is our One Cubic Foot study.
Now, is this from the place that you guys actually set up at?
Just across the river.
Okay.
The place that we set up, we have to go do by boat.
Okay.
So I just across the river. I got the waders on this morning. I went out and I found a sample of river water. And what I can't stress enough is how little effort I put into trying to finding the river water that I have here.
You can see things moving underneath.
And hopefully we can see things moving. And what we do this for is to illustrate the fact that every tiny space has an amazing amount of biotic life living in it.
Cool.
Biodiversity is everywhere. Even in an area of concern river that we heard from that video before, our Genesee River, everyone thinks it's highly polluted. And we had the question, scientific method, to is it highly polluted? So what we did was we went out there and we wanted to look at just what lives in the river. If we did water testing, we would see maybe it rained really hard that day, or maybe it was super dry for that week, and we might get kind of different levels of water testing depending on where you test in the water column.
Sure.
So what we did was we wanted to see what lived in the water, the neighborhood. So we went out and we looked at all the macroinvertebrates, or all the bugs, mostly.
The big stuff.
Yes. Yeah. Things you don't really need a microscope for. And what we have here is a little digital microscope that I like to use in the field. I can hook it up to my phone.
Cool.
We can zoom in on things with students in the field. And what we have here is a giant snail.
Okay.
It's a very large snail.
Wow.
And that was, again, I can't stress enough, two scoops of a bucket. Right. I wasn't looking for anything specifically. I just wanted to kind of prove a point that there's lots of life everywhere that we look. And what we can do is actually look at what lives in the water, and we know, the scientific community knows exactly what bugs can live where.
Everything's skimming across there, pretty cool.
Yeah. But you wouldn't normally see this without your microscope, correct?
No, so without the microscope, you would see just kind of murky water. You might be able to see, look, there's some stuff moving. You might be able to see some things swimming around, but most of the time we like to use the microscope to kind of illustrate exactly how small life can be, even if you don't know it's there. And what's interesting is we know what bugs live where, and we know what pollutants they can deal with. So what we know is certain bugs like caddisflies, mayflies, or even stoneflies cannot live where there's lots of pollution.
Okay.
And we know this. We've tested it many, many years. Okay. The scientific community knows these things. So what we've done is we look for those specific bugs. We also look for the other direction. So we look for leeches. We'll look for lunged snails, which is this guy right here. We'll look for things that can tolerate pollution, that can actually leave the water if they need to. They can live in kind of a murkier area.
Okay.
Our river is always going to be murky.
Sure.
With Genesee River, it's an agricultural river. It has a loose bottom, so it's going to be kind of always sooty. But that doesn't necessarily mean that it's polluted. And we actually, when we did this study, the one cubic foot study a couple years ago with David Litschwager, what we found was many different species of caddisfly, mayfly, and actually stonefly, which is great. So we know that the river is healthy enough to support that life.
Okay.
And because of things like that, we're seeing otters come back to the area. We're seeing sturgeon return back to the Genesee River, which is fantastic.
So healthy enough for humans to consume?
Still, we don't want to recommend eating a whole lot of things out of the river. The DEC has a wonderful recommendation as to how much fish you should be eating out of the river. But we like to kind of tell people that the river isn't a lost cause. It is full of life. And this is just one teeny little space in that area that we kind of collected. And as you can see, there's a giant snail. I can attest to the fact that I've seen a couple damselflies.
You can see some swimming over on the other side of the bucket towards
absolutely,
you.
Absolutely, absolutely. Amphipods, which are teeny little crustaceans, which are really, really nice to find because they are the base of the food level or of the food web for all of the Genesee River. So if we find lots of these things, then we can kind of quantify how healthy the creek is or how healthy the river is, which is great. And it's a little more touchier than water testing, but we like to do it and then we replicate it as many times as possible.
So now you sampling those things, does that give an indication to oxygen content in the river as well?
Certainly does. Caddisflies cannot live where there is a low amount of dissolved oxygen.
Okay.
So you'll see our Genesee River has a wonderful trout population that comes in trout running times. We have lots of salmon as well. And that is indicative of high dissolved oxygen, which
That's
is great.
Cool.
And also, we're seeing a lot of other bugs kind of rebounding back because of the good water quality,
cool.
which is nice.
So that's very cool.
You can do this other than in the river. You could go to lakes and do it in lake
water.
And
that's the point,
because I know that there's a lake that they consider dead in Syracuse.
Yes.
But you could maybe prove that it's not.
So what we do is, this is called citizen science, which is the larger picture here. And what it is when we have ideas or scientific problems or studies that are just too big for one group of scientists to handle, we standardize how you do it, and then we give it to children. We give it to school-age teachers. We give it to school groups. And then they can go out and they can collect that data and send it to real scientists like the Smithsonian Institute,
which
we partner with through the Seneca Park Zoo. And then we can get a lot of data done at one time, and then also jazz up kids, maybe get them a career in science, or even just get them a little more stewardship to their area.
So if we have teachers or classrooms that are interested in participating in this on the website at the Seneca Park Zoo?
Yes. On our website, we'd be more than welcome to come down, to go to their school, to even pick a little area of their property, or even bring them to the Genesee River, which we've been doing a lot with Rochester School District and some other different areas where kids have no idea that the river's even there, right in the middle of our city.
Right.
And then we bring them down, we stick them in waders, we get a net in their hands, and then we get them a little bit of ownership for the bugs and things that they're finding, which is fantastic.
Cool. So is this something that other people, like if I have a pond in my backyard, that I could set this up and analyze the water and send you guys results?
Absolutely. So what we use is an app called iNaturalist, which you can get on all of your phones. And then what we can do is you can take a picture of everything that you're finding. You can upload it to iNaturalist and actually tag us at the Seneca Park Zoo. And then we'll use that photo for a lot of our studies. We do say, though, that the DEC, you need a permit to collect bugs and bring them away from a river or a creek. But if you want to go out with the cube, just see what's living out there, take some pictures of some cool things that you may find, you're more than welcome to upload them to the app iNaturalist, or even just call us at the zoo, and then we'll take that data.
That is awesome.
Yeah.
Pictures, not videos, right?
Pictures, not videos, or a video, honestly, all of it works. And we like to connect people through many different types of media. We do Nature Journal Club, where we go out and we draw what we find.
Nice.
Every bit to connect everyone in the community to our local rivers, which is fantastic.
Dave, thanks for coming
in.
Yeah,
Dave,
no problem.
thank you very much.
This is
really cool.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right. We'd like to thank the Seneca Park Zoo for being here. Now stay right there, and we'll be back in a second.
Newton's first law of motion states that an object at rest tends to stay at rest, and an object in motion tends to stay in motion with the same direction and speed unless interfered with.
That was really kind of cool.
That was very cool. We want you guys to go to check that stuff out and send in the pictures of stuff you find.
Yes. I have a few things I'd like to review as well.
Excellent.
Okay, come on over. This is what we're going to do. Is I'm going to review some of the beginning pre-algebra stuff. One of the things I'm doing with my class in seventh grade is trying to find out exactly where they are. So by giving them a question like this that says, find the sum of the two expressions. The word expressions means no equal sign. So I need to remember that. So we're going to say no equal above that, just so you remember that. Now the word sum means to add. Now my students are kind of, they want us to write it in a long line. I'm not one of those that cares. You can do this where you do 2x plus 5, that's your first one, and then 3x minus 7, and you could do that. And you could draw your boxes where, okay, this is an x, and this is an x. These need to go together. Draw your circles so that because they're constants, they need to go together. You can do that, and that's fine. But I actually think sometimes it's easier, especially for students who are still struggling with algebra, to line them up. So I'm gonna do the 2x plus 5 on the top, and then I'm going to look at the other problem. It says 3x. Well, I have an x over there, so I'm going to line it up together. And I'm going to put the 3x underneath the other x, 2x, and then subtract 7. And now I can add them together. And now it looks like one of those typical addition problems you're used to from the elementary school. So now we're just going to add together. I have 5 plus a negative 7, because here's your separation, 5 plus a negative 7. Well, 5 plus negative 7 is negative 2, because I'm taking away more than what I have. I'm short 2. And then 2x plus 3x is 5x. So my final answer here would be 5x minus 2. Now, let's do a double check over here to make sure we could do that as well. 2x plus 3x, you get your 5x, and then you have your 5 and your negative 7, and you put them together. Again, you're taking away more than you have, so I have a minus 2. I got the same answer both times, so it really doesn't matter which of the two methods you use. I hope that helps.
All right, we have Nassim. Hi, Nassim. How are you? Hey, Nassim. All right, so when Nassim was our winner, and he knew that it was the red-eyed tree frog, and he was going to tell us some cool stuff, and one of the things that I learned is they're very bright color green.
Yeah, and a neon green, it said.
And you would think that that would be a bad thing, but what that they're saying is that the animals that eat the tree frogs, this color, intense color saturates their eyes and leaves like a blinding, so it's... They don't see it for a second while the frog takes off and gets away.
Right.
And maybe not all the time, but still.
And if you look, if you have a picture, their feet look like little suction cups.
Sure, they hang upside down, hang on the bottom of a leaf.
So. Yeah, there you
Thanks,
go.
Thanks, Nassim. Congratulations. Don't forget, every correct response goes into our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. Earn enough points, and you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
Tomorrow on Homework Hotline, history teacher Howard Krug will be here to talk to us about the Vietnam War.
Good night.
Good night.
We'll be right back.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers, working with parents and the community for our children's future. NYSET, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.